Good evening and welcome to the Lord's house as we gather for worship here and just give thanks and praise to God for his many gifts. But tonight especially we focus on the precious gift and blessing of heaven. What a glorious promise we have through our faith in Jesus Christ that we carry with us each and every day. And so we will focus on that as we consider God's word here this evening. At this time, I'd like to invite Carol Rave to tell us a little bit about the mission of the month. Every month, we have another mission here that we support at St. Paul, and so Carol will tell us a little bit about this month's.
Good evening. The missions of the month for August are Peace Campus Center and International Student Ministry. Did you know that over 1 million international students have gone to school in the United States in the year 2022? What an amazing thing to have the mission fields come to us. So both of these focus on helping and support that mission. Peace Campus Center is a place where students, both domestic ones from here and international ones, can make friends, they can study his word, they can participate in service projects and mission trips and worship opportunities. Pastor Andy's over there and a lot of you have had exposure with Peace. The International Student Ministry is something I just learned about. It is a recognized service organization of LCMS. It is set up to help students, Christians, Lutherans, be intentional friends to international students. They work to set up programs where we can be host families to make friends to these international students so that through us we can talk to them about the love of Jesus. They also help universities set up international programs and also have an in-depth Bible study. I met Sue Hasselbring. She's down in St. Louis, but she's the kind of the catalyst for this. Their website actually has some really cool informational pages. So if you are friends with somebody, an international person, both students or like even like for us, like our Afghan families, it talks about ways to interact with them that allow you to become their friends and then tell them about Jesus. So please pray for both these missions, support them financially, and UWSP does have a friendship family program. So if you want to be a host, like meet with an international student a couple times a month, it's a program that's still going on there. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. One other announcement for this evening. We have our fourth and final listening session taking place immediately following this worship service, and it will be here in the sanctuary. So if you walk out and come back in, or if you just want to stay where you're at for the listening session, you're encouraged to do so, but that'll be happening immediately following our worship service here this evening. Again, welcome to Lord's House. Our bell will call us to worship, and we'll begin with the singing of our opening hymn, 801, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We pray. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He covers the heavens with clouds. He prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass grow on the hills. He gives to the beasts their food, and to the young ravens that cry. His delight is not in the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the legs of a man. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those whose hope is steadfast love. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. The Lord be with you.
Let
us pray. Almighty and merciful God, it is by your grace that we live as your people who offer acceptable service. Grant that we may walk by faith and not by sight in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated.
The Old Testament reading is from Genesis chapter 15. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me, for I continue childless? And their heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and number the stars. If you are able to number them, then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Hebrews chapter 11. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. By faith Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was condemned by righteousness as righteous, God condemning him by accepting his gifts, and through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found, because God had taken him. Now before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God, and without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear constructed an ark for saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed what was called to go out to a place, and he was to receive as an inheritance. As he went out, not knowing where he was going, by faith he went to live in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise, for he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him good as dead, were born descendants as many of the stars of heaven and as many of the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have an opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us rise.
Hallelujah.
Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? If then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass, which is alive in the field today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And do not seek what you are to eat and what you are to drink, nor be worried. For all the nations of the world seek after these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things will be added to you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure in heaven that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Join together in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Congregation may be seated, and we join in singing our hymn of the day, hymn 720, "We Walk by Faith and Not by Sight."
We
Grace, mercy, and peace, they are yours today. They are gifts to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Binoculars. Maybe you've used them when you went hunting. Or maybe you used them when you went to an athletic event. Maybe you use them bird watching. Some of you bird watchers, maybe you are, but maybe you use them bird watching. Binoculars are kind of cool. They bring into clear and close focus that which is distant or that which might be unseen by the human eye. One of the fun things to do with binoculars is turn them around, right? And look through them backwards. I don't know if you ever, I'm sure you've done that, right? And you look at them and you just, everything that was so close now seems so far away. It's incredible. And I'm sure you would agree that that is not really the way those binoculars should be used. But unfortunately, many people, including Christians, go through life with binoculars backwards. Today we're using binoculars, so to speak, in the correct way. In that correct way to show that we have an incredible promise from God. We are looking long and hard at the promised gift of heaven. That promise that we have through Jesus Christ our Lord. In bringing that great promise into view, we have strength and comfort for all our days. Turning to our epistle lesson tonight for our text from Hebrews 11, verses 9 and 10. By faith, he, Abraham, went to live in the land of promise as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. Folks, the promise of heaven is real. It is absolutely real. You might say that goes without saying. Well, no, I think sometimes we have to say it. We need to remind ourselves of it. We know it's real because Jesus says it's real. That familiar passage from John chapter 14, verses 2 and 3. Jesus says, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you." A place. We hear in that gospel lesson tonight where Jesus says, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." To give it. To give you the kingdom. The Apostle Paul talks about it as well. One of my favorite passages from Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. Paul writes and says, "Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body." In heaven, bodily, physically, it's real. Just last week we had in that epistle lesson from last week, Colossians chapter 3, verse 4, "When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory." Isn't that incredible? You will also appear with him in glory. Not you might appear with him in glory, or you could appear with him in glory. You will appear with him in glory. It's real. The promise is real. And then we have our text tonight. from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. For he, Abraham, was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. A city, a place that's real, built and designed for us by God. But sometimes I think that we have lost our heavenly perspective. When was the last time you entertained the thought of heaven? Maybe we're looking through the binoculars backwards. Because it can lead us to think that this whole idea and concept of heaven is a long way away. It's way down there, and there's so much to do right here and now that sometimes the here and now gets in the way of the there and the then, the there and then of heaven. Sometimes we might even consider heaven to be almost an interruption to the here and now. I've got so many things to do, so many places I want to go, so many things I want to see, that heaven is kind of, we want it way down there because we just got so many to do here and now. And we don't see things. We don't see things rightly as God lays them out for us. Looking backwards through the binoculars gives us a wrong view. And maybe sometimes that view is not that this is way down there a long time from now. Maybe it gives us that view of thinking, boy, that's a long, long way away as we look through the binoculars backwards. That's a long, long way. And I'm not sure I can get there. And I'm not sure I can reach it. And we might even become a little hopeless. Folks, we need to turn the binoculars around and look the right way. And it brings that promise into view. It brings that promise close to us, for we are looking forward to a city, a place that is sure and secure and permanent. It has foundations. And its builder and its architect is God. And he has built it for us. This is our promise through faith in Jesus Christ. Through his shed blood and his redemptive sacrifice, our sin is removed. Our separation is gone. I love what Paul says in chapter 2. We who were far off have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Brought near. Forgiven. That separation has been removed. We are forgiven. We have that promise that through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, it brings our resurrection from the dead into view. It brings the promise of eternal life, that eternal city that God has provided for us, into view. It is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You have the promise of the living God, that your death will be swallowed up in victory. Think of that. Swallowed up in victory. Jesus rose from the dead, not just to show you his power, but to show you the way. He is the way to eternal life. He is the one who is able to take us to that place that is sure and secure. That is the view that we have through our faith every day. The gift and promise of heaven. With the there and then in view, it helps us to see the here and now rightly. It helps to see our everyday life correctly. The here and now is temporary. It's temporary, and we see that in the text. As Abraham talks about acknowledging, or the writer of the Hebrews acknowledges that Abraham were strangers and exiles in the land. Temporary. They were seen as living in tents in the promised land. Why? Because they knew that wasn't their home. Tents with stakes. They could pick them up and move them, and they did. It was temporary. But they were looking for the city with foundations, that which is sure. Now, temporary isn't a bad thing. It doesn't mean that it's bad. God gives good gifts for us in the here and now. He gives us many blessings in the here and now. But there are greater blessings in store for you and me in the there and then of heaven. What God wants us to know is, don't cling to this world. There is so much better for us. Greater gifts in His kingdom for all eternity. And so the there and the then of heaven help us to see the here and now rightly. This is temporary, but God has given us that promise of eternal life with Him. And with that vision of heaven in view, the promise brings security. It brings strength for all our todays. Imagine, if you would please, a cold winter's night. I know that's kind of hard here at the beginning of August, right? But imagine a cold winter's night. Snow coming down sideways. The wind is howling. It's bitter cold, and here's a man walking down the street. He's not wandering aimlessly. He is walking with a purpose. He is walking with a purpose because he has a vision. He's on his way home. He knows when he gets there, it will be warm. He knows when he gets there that his family will welcome him. He knows when he gets there that there will be a meal ready for him. He's walking with that vision of home. That vision gives him strength, gives him confidence to walk through the storm of the here and now, knowing where he's going. And folks, so do you. You have the confidence and the assurance of walking through all the storms of the here and now, knowing where you're going. By God's grace, through faith in Jesus Christ, we walk today in confidence, assurance, and joy with the view of heaven, knowing that that's the city of foundations. That is our permanent, secure place that God has prepared for us. Things in the here and now, they will change. They're temporary. But God's promise, it will never change. We, like Abraham, are looking forward to the city with foundations, whose builder and architect is God. What a promise. What a view. What a gift. And it's yours. It's yours through Jesus Christ, your Savior. Therefore, I murmur not. Heaven is my home. Whate'er my earthly lot, heaven is my home. And I will surely stand there at my Lord's right hand. Heaven is my fatherland. Heaven is my home. And it's yours through Jesus Christ our Lord. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in true faith unto Christ Jesus our Savior. Amen. Let us pray for ourselves, the church around the world, and all people in their various circumstances. Let us all rise for prayer. God said, "Fear not, Abram, I am your shield." Let us pray for everyone who faces this day in fear. We join our prayers with everyone imprisoned unjustly, terrorized in lawless areas on earth, or trapped in painful illnesses. Gracious God, strengthen the faith they have or open their hearts to receive the gospel. Give them courage to act where it is wise and to know your peace and protection amid unchanging circumstances. Lord, hear our prayer. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. Jesus said, "Do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on." Let us pray for all people who do not have adequate food, clothing, or shelter. Guide governments, expand relief agencies, and inspire caring individuals of our communities, nations, and world so they may be your instruments, O God, to provide what their citizens and neighbors need for life. Through their actions, provide relief and calm the anxiety of the poor, dispossessed, and lonely. Grant that they give you glory. Meet their needs as fits your gracious plans for them. Hear, Lord, hear our prayer. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. Jesus asserted, "It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Let us pray for the church here and around the world. Grant us growth in faith and numbers, Lord Jesus, as we gather to hear your word, celebrate the sacraments, and love the people around us. Wherever the church is found on earth, raise up leaders to proclaim the gospel and faithful people to exhibit their faith in your promises and the inheritance you have promised. Lord, hear our prayer, and let your steadfast love, Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Let us pray for people who do not see the results of their labors in the lives of other people. Heavenly Father, strengthen and support farmers awaiting harvest, ranchers providing food and pasture for their flocks, shopkeepers greeting clients, all who work from home, those in offices, and those working in the factories. Grant them a vision of the wider roles to provide harvest, supplies, and products to meet the needs of people they cannot see. Grant them a willingness to serve you by faith as they use their talents and abilities together with so many others. Lord, hear our prayer. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. These and any other things you would have us ask of you, Heavenly Father, grant to us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Holy, holy.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Jesus Christ, true Lamb of God, you take us in of the world, O Lord.
Let us rise. Children of God, be of good cheer, for your sins are freely forgiven, and the promise of eternal life, heaven, is yours through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, your Savior. And now, our Lord's true body and blood, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. We pray. Loving God, thank you for this meal of ordinary bread and wine, which according to the words of Jesus are for us his very body and blood. As you call us into new life out of nothing, strengthen us now and always through the faith in the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns in communion and love with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.